You are listening to TBR Radio Presents, The Dixie Heritage Show, with your host, the Director of Dixie Heritage, Dr. Ed DeVries.
They say there's a place where dreams have all gone. They never said where. But I think I know it's miles through the night, just over the dawn, on the road that will take me home. I know in my bones I've been here before. The ground feels the same.
No doubt most of our listeners recognized that as the opening sequence to that great epic movie, Gods and Generals, that came out about 15 years ago, telling the story of the war between the states from its beginning until about the time of the death of General Stonewall Jackson. That opening sequence, of course, being the song Going Home, written and performed by singer-songwriter Mary Fahl. Mary's going to be our guest today on TBR Radio Presents, the Dixie Heritage Show, and it's going to be a great conversation, so stay tuned.
Hello.
Hello, Mary.
Yes.
Hi, this is Edward DeVries with TBR Radio. How are you today?
Oh, hi, Edward. How are you? Can you hear me all right?
Yes, ma'am. I've been an admirer of your work for a number of years. I don't know why I didn't think to do this sooner.
Everything happens when it's supposed to happen, right? So you're a Civil War buff.
That's what people call me.
Well, it's funny because I guess you probably don't know me from October Project. That was sort of a band back in the 90s. And when I left that band, we we broke up. They've since reunited, but I went off on my own, and it took me a couple of years, but I started writing my own songs. About 3 years after parting or so, I got a deal with Sony Classical, and it was just unexpected. It was one of those things. Isn't it funny in life that the nicest, best things are always kind of come in unexpected packages? I was called up there and to audition. I had figured that I was never going to get another deal because I was about, maybe 40 at the time. And, you know, in the music business, you might as well be 100, you know. And
Bob Dylan just released a new song the other day. And so,
well, I mean, he's a legacy artist, so you know what I mean. But speaking of Dylan, we'll get to him in a minute because I'm going to tie him into this story. Okay. So, and this is the best story about going home, which is the song that I wrote for the Civil War film, Gods and Generals. So here's how it came about. So I was called up and I ended up auditioning for Sony a week after 9/11. And I went up there and I didn't know what to expect, but I sang for them and I sang some of my own songs and I sang an opera piece. And I'm not an opera singer. I've never been trained or anything, but I like it. I like the beautiful arias. And, you know, because I'm not trained, I would never have considered anybody taking me seriously singing that. It's just something I do for myself. But when they called me up to audition for them, they said, "We want you to sing an aria." And I laughed and I said, "What, like Nessun Dorma? And they said, "Oh, do you know it?" And I said, "Yeah, I know it. I know them all. I sing them." But yeah. So anyway, cut to the chase. I went up, I sang for them, and they signed me right then and there, and which was shocking. And I just didn't see that coming. But what they said to me was, "We think that what you do is very cinematic, and we would like you to write for some movies. We can't guarantee that you'll get a song in the film, but we release a lot of movie soundtracks." And so I was thinking about that. I thought, oh, I'd love that challenge, you know? And so I remember one of my first meetings with them after I was signed. I said, "Well, what do you have in the hopper here in terms of movies?" And they said, "Well, we're just finishing up the soundtrack for Gods and Generals." And I knew Gods and Generals because I had read the Jeff Sharon novel. And here's the deal. My dad and I came from a big family, big Catholic family. I was right in the middle. So when you have a large family and you know, you sort of have to get the attention of your parents by sharing sort of unique things with them. And with my dad and I, it was a love of history and especially a love of Civil War history. And I was actually a history major when I was at university. It was medieval history, but still, I just love history. My whole family loves history. We kind of share books. And
I read that you went to McGill University. That's in Canada,
I did.
Correct?
That's right. It's in Montreal.
And
yeah.
So mm-hmm. I'm guessing that the American Civil War probably wouldn't have been a big topic of study in a Canadian university.
No. This was just a personal thing. And my dad and I would share books. And, you know, I just remember I have very loving memories of, you know, Bruce Catton books and, you know, it's that there's the Sheridan book, Battle Cry of Freedom, and gosh, there's so many, Shelby Foote, all that stuff. We just trade books back and forth. Anyway, so when I saw they were doing Gods and Generals, I thought, you know, I could write a song for that. I understand that. And so I got to work and I thought, I'll try to make the song sound kind of like a Stephen Foster song. And I'm sure your audience would know Stephen Foster was sort of the big pop songwriter of the Civil War era. And and interestingly,
refresh my memory, he wrote Home on the Swanee River,
Jeannie,
right?
Yeah, and he wrote Jeannie with the Light Brown Hair and Beautiful Dreamer and My Old Kentucky Home and Hard Times Come Again No More. And I mean, he just kept the hits on coming. And so my dad, when we were little kids, and falling asleep at night, he would come in and sometimes he would sing to us. And he didn't have a good voice, but he used to sing some of those beautiful Stephen Foster songs. And so I felt as if you know, there was something in my DNA that was appropriate to write something for the Civil War. And my dad also, even though he was a very pragmatic man, would often say to me that when he visited Gettysburg, he knew in his soul that he had been there, that he had been a soldier, a Union soldier. And that's just not the kind of thing my dad would say lightly. He just didn't talk like that, you know. So it was interesting. Anyway, I got to work on the song. And they said, you know, we can't promise you, you know, we'll bring it to the director, but, you know, he's already done with the movie. I mean, the soundtrack is basically finished. So, but, you know, so I finished the song. And just as I was about to finish it, I also found out that Bob Dylan had been commissioned to write the theme song. And it was done. And I thought, oh, well, great. I don't have a chance in hell. Come on. That's it. You know, why bother? And so I finished the song anyway, just because, you know, I was almost done. But you could tell I just thought I didn't have a chance at all because I didn't put a whole lot of work into the demo. Normally, for something like that, I'd have really gone out and gotten the best musicians and every, you know. But I figured, why bother? So it was just me and a piano and a guitar, and that was it. And so I gave it to my A&R person who was handling me at Sony Classical, and I forgot about it. And then he called me up and said, I want to tell you something that happened today. The director was up here, Ron Maxwell, and I said to him, you know, one of our artists wrote a song, and he said, no, I don't want to hear it. We're done. We're done. And he said, just sit down and listen. Just take a listen. And I think he just begrudgingly sat down. He said, all right, fine, I'll listen. So they put him in the big Sony conference room, you know, a very sterile kind of stiff environment. But they had those big Sony speakers. And so they sat him down. And, you know, this is what they told me, that they put it on and he listened. And then he put his head down. And then in the middle of the song, he got up and he walked over to one of those big speakers and he put one hand on the speaker and another hand on his heart. And when it was done, he said, she absolutely gets this. She understands this movie. She gets it. And so he ended up putting it at the front of the film. And so the film opens with all of the different flags of the various regiments. And my song plays, and he put Bob's at the end. So that's the story of the Gods and Generals song, Going Home. And what's interesting is that subsequent to that, you know, the movie came out, and as I'm sure you know, it didn't, to say that it didn't do well at the box office is putting it mildly. You know, it got bad reviews and everything. I mean, my personal opinion is that it probably should have been a made-for-television like Gettysburg, because that was the same director, and it was a big success for them on TNT. But, you know, what happened happened, and the movie went away, and, you know, my dreams of getting an Oscar nomination maybe were dashed forever and ever, and that was that. And I forgot about it. And years later, I started getting these letters from servicemen and women overseas, and I was thinking, why am I getting these letters? And it was all about Going Home, and I guess they must have been showing the movie at bases, you know, in Afghanistan and Iraq and really those godforsaken places like that. And so I would get the most beautiful, heartfelt letters that they just loved the song. And it just happened again the other day. And that somehow they found the song extremely soothing to them, and that it helped with their PTSD, or it helped help them sleep through the night at, you know, at their various bases. And you just never know what a song will do for people. Mm-hmm. And I often think that if everything had gone the way that initially I had hoped it would go when it got in the movie, and, you know, I might have had, you know, maybe a dusty old Oscar sitting on a mantle somewhere that nobody would give a damn about. Somehow the song found a better way.
Open your web browser and type in www.barnesreview.org and discover the Barnes Review magazine. In the Barnes Review, you will read vignettes of man, from the prehistoric to the very recent, from forgotten races and civilizations to first-person accounts of World War II and the late Cold War. There is no more interesting magazine published today, nor a more significant and important subject than real history. So visit www.barnesreview.org and subscribe to the Barnes Review. You can subscribe to receive the Barnes Review magazine in its print form, or in convenient electronic delivery. Our host has been a subscriber to both formats for years. So visit www.barnesreview.org and subscribe to the Barnes Review.
When that song was coming up on, as the movie began, there yes. was a poem that came up on the screen as your song was beginning to play. And it was by George Eliot, or actually George Eliot was a female poet by the name of Mary Evans,
right.
but you know, George Eliot was a pen name.
Yeah. Yeah.
And, and she said, a human life, I think, should be well rooted in some spot of native land where it may get the love of tender kinship for the face of the earth, for the labors of men to go forth, for the sounds and accents that haunt it, for whatever will yeah. give that early home a familiar, unmistakable difference amidst the future widening of knowledge. A spot where the definiteness of early memories may be inwrought with affection and kindly acquaintance with all neighbors, even to the dogs and donkeys, may spread by sentimental effort and reflection, but is a sweet habit of the blood. And then at the end, the poem says, the best introduction to astronomy is to think of the mighty heavens as a little lot of stars belonging to one's own homestead. Was that something that inspired you to write the song, or was that something that Maxwell put in after the fact?
No. And it's nope. I remember writing it, and I'll be honest, I was never a huge George Eliot fan. I had to read Middlemarch way back in college. I just, you know, but, and I was not familiar with that poem at all. And I think that Ron put that in there after the song. I don't know what actually happened, but I remember that he commented to me, I had dinner with him, and he said, you know, what struck me about your song was, I have a long way to go, the stars tell me so. And so what I do when I write, especially for a movie or for a book, is that I try to write it from the perspective of the perspective of a soldier. And what would a soldier dream of? What would be a song that would be in their head? And so I was just thinking about you fight for your home. They were all fighting for their home. They would be laying at night and dreaming of home and looking up at the stars. It just came to me. And that was the line that Ron liked the best. And he said, you know, you really get that part of it. Just honestly, it just popped into my head.
Extra, read all about it.
If you're like me, and I'll bet you are, you like to be on the cutting edge of honest news and accurate information. 26 times a year, the American Free Press newspaper can be delivered to your door, packed with the kind of uncensored news that I know you're going to appreciate. If you're ever dissatisfied with your subscription to the American Free Press, their guarantee is that you just drop them an email, and they will gladly refund the unused portion of your subscription. So what are you waiting for? Visit www.americanfreepress.net. Once again, www.americanfreepress.net, and find out about the American Free Press. Do it today.
Extra, read all about it.
So had you seen the movie before you began writing the song, or was it you just read the book?
No, I just read the book, and I didn't even remember when I'm writing this, I don't even know that I'm going to get this gig. In fact, by the time I finish it, I think I don't have a chance. No, it just came, I just remembered the book and about that concept of home being so essential, the sense of the motivation of the characters and so forth. Anyway, in fact, it was so much fun. Was one of the highlights of my life, actually, when they had the big premiere in Washington, D.C., because I brought my family down with me, and they all got to sit next to different senators and things like that. So then they had a big party afterwards, and it was just a lot of fun, and it was very exciting. So no, that was the first time I ever saw the film, was when it premiered, and I saw the flags, and to hear your music and have that visual stimulation as well was just it was marvelous. It really was.
At the premiere, were you in period attire or formal attire?
No. I just wore a nice dress. Okay. That's all.
So when you saw the film, you know, having read the book, and this is this might be an unfair question, and if it is, just tell me so. We'll move on. But having read the book, how well do you think the film and the book, and then what you actually know of the history, how well do you think it came together?
I think Ron did his best. You know, he's very careful about being true to history. He tries very hard. He really does. I think it could have been tighter cinematically. I think the movie was too long, basically. I think people have short attention spans. So as I said, I think that it would have been better, and he could have gone even deeper into things if it had been a made-for-television where he could have done it over a series of episodes. That's what I'm going to say.
Okay.
I think it would have been better in that format.
Yeah. When you...
Because I thought Gettysburg was done so well.
Right.
Do you agree?
I love Gettysburg.
Yeah.
I really wish that they would have cast Robert Duvall in Gettysburg rather than Martin Sheen. Not that I don't like Martin Sheen as an actor. I just didn't think he did Lee all that well.
Captured. Yeah.
Not the Gettysburg. The Gods and Generals theatrical release was about 3.5 hours long, but the actual film was over 5 hours long. So at the premiere, did they show the theatrical release, or did you sit through all 5 hours?
No. It was the shorter version.
Okay. About 2 years later, the full version came out. And I had ordered the DVD. I pre-ordered the DVD thinking it was going to be the full 5 hours. And they sent me the theatrical release on DVD, and I was very disappointed. And a couple of years later, I got the full 5 hours. And I guess, like you said, I'm a Civil War buff, I guess. So that's why I could sit through the full 5 hours and enjoy it.
Yeah. I don't think your average person, especially a non-history loving person, would have the attention span to do that. Again, unless it was episodic. I think the perfect Civil War film has yet to have been done. I think that there's some of history is interpreted through a particular lens that isn't always fair to both sides. Gods and Generals was a little more fair in that way.
Welcome to the Christendom curriculum. You know, every parent who decides to homeschool wants to secure a great education for their child, while also saving time and money. But these days, many parents have another concern. They also want a homeschool curriculum without all the multiculturalist, politically correct diversity doctrine that's really little more than a thin disguise for an anti-Christian, anti-American, and anti-Western civilization bias. Now there is such a curriculum. The Christendom curriculum gives your children a complete education in Bible, history, literature, and more, focusing on the classic academic skills of reading, writing, and arithmetic. But we also tell the story of Christendom, the story of the Christian nations, especially as Christ's kingdom has been historically manifest in the nations of Europe and America. And we do so without apology. The Christendom curriculum is the only Christian nationalist homeschool program you'll find. We support the right of the European and American peoples to their historic Christian cultures against the globalist leftists who want to destroy those cultures. Not only that, but we provide assigned reading courses for various hot-button subjects in our current culture wars, including feminism, social justice, and cultural Marxism, among others. These reading courses will teach your kids how to survive a social justice warrior attack, how to debate with leftists on social media, how to reform their local churches and communities, and more. We're living in a time of tremendous historical and social change. Christians have the opportunity now to begin building the culture and civilization of the next 1,000 years and beyond. It's an exciting time to be alive. So if you want to help raise the next generation of culture warriors, if you want your children to grow up with a love for Christ's kingdom and for their own nation, while at the same time learning how to defend America and rebuild the West, the easy-to-use Christendom curriculum is for you. Click the Learn More button to get in on the action. And thanks for listening.
I'm curious, do you have any ancestors from the war between the states, be they northern or southern?
No, all I know is that my grandfather, Fahl, Fahl is my mother's maiden name. My last name was much longer, and it was just a big, ugly German last name. So I took my mother's maiden name, and also because my grandfather, Edmund Fahl, but you know, he was Papa Fahl, he gave me my first guitar and really encouraged me as a singer and musician and everything. So it just seemed appropriate to take, it's just a nicer last name. So the Fahls, his father's father made Union, he was a tailor, he made Civil War uniforms for the Union side in New York. I don't have any Southern relatives at all. Okay. I come from a German-Irish background. So my ancestors were all either German immigrants or Irish immigrants. It's very typical.
You know, I commented to some people after I had watched Gods and Generals. You know, there was a civil war going on in Ireland as well. And there was also a famine going on, which forced a lot of the Irish to come to America.
Yes, that's when my mother's relatives came over.
To some degree, the Irish almost... they enlisted in both armies in this country, and it was almost because most of the Catholics immigrated to the north and most of the Protestants immigrated to the south. And it was almost like they used our Civil War as an opportunity to continue fighting their own.
That's such an interesting. Yeah. In fact, there's all those stories of those poor Irishmen getting off the boat from Ireland and getting put into a uniform immediately. Basically, they used them as cannon fodder. Let's just call it what it is. That's what they did.
Hello, I'm Tom Strain, Lieutenant Commander-in-Chief of the Sons of Confederate Veterans. The Confederate flag, Confederate symbols, and the reputation of our Confederate ancestors has come under attack. The Sons of Confederate Veterans is actively fending off our detractors, but there is only so much that we can do. We need your help. Contact your local, state, and national elected politicians and tell them that you will not tolerate these attacks on our heritage. You can also visit scb.org, download an application to join us in our fight to preserve our Southern heritage. Visit scb.org today. If you don't have a Confederate ancestor and you are tired of American history disappearing, you can assist us by becoming a friend of the SCB. Please visit scbheritagedefense.org and make a donation to the Heritage Defense Fund. We hope that you will join us in the fight to defend the Confederate soldier's good name.
That word from the Sons of Confederate Veterans. We are now all but out of time for this week's TBR Radio Presents the Dixie Heritage Show. But tune in again, same time, same place next week. And we will continue this wonderful conversation with Mary Fahl. I know that you'll look forward to hearing the conclusion of that conversation just as much as I enjoyed having it with Mary. So be sure to come back again next week, and Mary will once again be our guest. Until then, go to our website, www.dixieheritage.net, www.dixieheritage.net, and check out our website, check out our bookstore. Sign up to receive our free weekly newsletter, the Dixie Heritage Letter. It'll come into your email box every Friday, packed full of information that you'll want to read. And there's no cost, no obligation whatsoever. All you have to do, just give us your email address and we'll start sending that to you. And when you sign up for the newsletter, I will also send you a free ebook copy of my best-selling book, The Truth About the Confederate Battle Flag. So be sure to do that. Anyways, from all of us here at TBR Radio, until next week, God bless. See you again soon.